Point Blank is a crime fiction podcast. It may not be suitable for all listeners. We discuss violence in all its forms. The works we reference may include period slang, which some listeners may find offensive. The hosts also have a tendency to swear.
Episode 43, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? By Philip K. Dick. Feels like a mouthful. That's a lot to get into that intro.
Yeah, that's a lot of words. It's a wordy title.
All right, welcome back to Point Blank. Justin and I have strapped ourselves into our hover car, and we are zooming up and down the West Coast in search of androids. Detective Justin, how's it going? And is your blaster ready to take out some illicit artificial intelligence?
They are. I'm looking to find and murder a android Wookiee.
Well, that... probably easier said than done. But yes, we're here today to talk about the book, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? Or perhaps you could look at it as we're about to talk about the film Blade Runner. So that's what we've got on the plate today. Today we're diving deep, so there's going to be spoilers in this one. I think we can probably assume most people are familiar with the premise of Blade Runner. I mean, it's only, you know, how many years old now, Justin?
It's not as old as either of us, but it's damn close.
Damn close. Good way to put it. All right. So are you excited for this discussion today, Justin?
I am, except for being sick. I'm feeling pretty good. This was a good book. There's a lot to talk about for a slim volume, 220 pages. There's enough material, enough ideas in this book to probably fill several podcasts, a whole series.
That's probably, maybe we should just get right at it today.
Let's dive right in and see where it takes us.
How about a summary of Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep?
So, Philip K. Dick, you might know him, folks. He's been dead since the year Blade Runner was released, 1982. But in 1968, he wrote one of his best-known books, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? Which was the premise for the Blade Runner film. They're not the same. There are themes from the film or from the book in the film, but the book is more than what you see in Blade Runner. The main character's name is Rick Deckard. You might picture Harrison Ford from the film, but it's not quite the same guy. This is a different character, and it sometimes is weird to take such a well-known film that you know very well inside and out, and then read its source material so long after all the images and ideas from the film are in your head. I have to undo a lot of what the film has done, as good as it is, and sort of revisit this world and these characters from a blank slate. Not easy to do, but Philip K. Dick's writing is pretty good, and he does a good job of establishing the reader. So, what about Deckard? He's a different kind of cop. He's a bounty hunter who works for the San Francisco Police Department in post-apocalyptic United States. At this point in the world's history, which was initially 1992 in the first editions of Dick's novel, it became 2021 in later editions. So we're right around the point where this was happening in Dick's future envisioning. But in this world, humans on Earth have largely left in the wake of nuclear disaster. They've moved to Mars as colonists, and they brought with them as an incentive to move their androids that serve as servants, as slaves, as an underclass. And we don't see any of that on Mars. We're not privy to that world. We just hear about it through the television and through conversations in the story from those who have been left behind or who have decided to stay on Earth. Those who have decided to stay, some of them are there because they want to. Some of them are there because they're not allowed to leave. The derogatory word for them is chickenheads. They're stupid, dysfunctional, unproductive people who don't meet the IQ threshold. They live on Earth like they always have in little pockets of space that haven't been raised by nuclear destruction, but they still need the infrastructure of society. They need bakeries and stores, and they need cops to police them. And Deckard is one of these. Like I said, he works for the San Francisco PD, but he's a specialist, and his job is to pursue and retire androids that are out and about in places they shouldn't be. The early models of androids were clearly, you know, not human. They were robotic. But the new models are, it's more difficult to tell. They are so close to being human that at what point do they exceed the tests that are used to determine whether or not they have the empathic ability to be human-like? So that's one of the big themes, the big questions that Dick raises. What does it mean to be human? And these androids that Deckard hunts are very, very realistic, and they are pretty much are in exile, having fled Mars, having fled their servitude. They've come back to the Earth and live in hiding, working odd jobs, bumming around, isolating themselves, and pretty much playing cat and mouse with the cops on Earth. What about them? Deckard hunts them down, and he retires them. And why? What's the point? Well, the point is, it's his job, and when he does do his bounty hunter work, he gets bonuses. Sort of like when there are bounties on either Native Americans or on animals in the conquest of the Americas, people would come back with evidence of their kills and get a bounty. That's what's happening here, and Deckard wants to use this money, these large chunks of change he receives for murdering these androids, to buy pets, essentially. There is this narrative that doesn't exist in the film about the status symbol of having pets, real pets, because in this post-apocalyptic future, there's not much life. There aren't animals. There aren't birds in the sky. Animals are very rare, so most people have android or robotic animals that serve as a simulacrum of a true pet, and those who actually can afford it have true real animals like sheep or goats or mice or whatnot. Right now, Deckard has an android sheep, and it's not good enough, and it doesn't last long ultimately, but what he wants is something that's real, and this money will pay for it. Here's the plot. Six Nexus 6 droids, these are the high-functioning droids that are analogous to human beings, need to be found and retired, and Deckard's job is to do it to get the money to buy a pet. These were built by the Rosen Corporation, which is run by Eldon Rosen, who has a niece named Rachel. You might be familiar with that name from the films. And she is, though we think perhaps that she is human and she is under the impression that she's human, she is actually found out to be one of these high-functioning Nexus 6 androids. She's not marked for extermination, though. She's not one of the escapees from Mars. These Nexus 6, unlike the film, are not highly skilled, super badass fighters. They're just sort of regular folks. They're a little bit, I guess, pathetic, introspective. They're not anything special. They're just regular people, in essence, who happen to be androids. Deckard does find one early in the story and retires it, kills it. And in the process of killing another one of them, who happens to be a well-liked opera singer, she calls the cops on him and gets him reported, and a cop comes and arrests Decker for attempted murder. It turns out, though, that he gets brought to a fake police department. It's not San Francisco PD, because he would know. This police department, in a very trippy scene I found, it's actually run by androids who act as cops. And there's a bounty hunter who works with this police department named Phil Rash, who he himself thinks is working for police officers. And his job, he thinks, is to retire androids. But what he's actually doing is retiring the bounty hunters that are coming after the true androids. So it's a nice little flip of the script here. A nice, clever scheme that the androids have cooked up to delude and confuse would-be assassins. It was an interesting moment. Anyway, he figures this stuff out. Phil comes to his rescue, and they both get out of there. But I'll leave that there. This is a story about ideas. It raises a lot of big questions. What does it mean to be alive? What does it mean to be human? What makes one human? And how is humanity maintained? And Dick doesn't answer these questions for us, which I'm glad he doesn't. And it leaves us to figure it out. There's another subplot tied to the Nexus 6 androids. A character named Isidore is a chicken head who lives on the edge of the city. And when he's not working at his dead-end job, he watches TV. He watches Buster Friendly, the never-ending talk show host, who probably is an android himself. And during his time in his house, just sort of chilling, he befriends a new visitor or resident in the apartment complex. And this resident's name is Briss. She's actually one of the Nexus 6 androids. And she moves in after befriending Isidore. And she brings her pals Ray and Irmgard, all of whom are being sought by Decker for retirement. So this sort of sets up that final moment when Deckard comes together and finds his, I guess you call it, prey. Another theme or thread in this novel, and like I said, there's a lot going on here for 200 pages, is this whole religion called Mercerism, which is named after a guy named with the last name of Mercer. It's built on empathy, and it features a savior. The savior named Mercer is a hybrid of Jesus Christ and Sisyphus, and people access or gain access to this religion through a device they have in their homes called an empathy box. And it's essentially virtual reality. You go into this box and you feel like you're part of something greater than yourself. You feel connected, empathic, and helps to offset the deep alienation of this future society. Who can practice Mercerism? It's not for everybody, and that's another question that Dick raises. This is something that we don't see in the films, and I'm glad to see it here. It might be a little more than some might like, but I do think it's an interesting concept. Ultimately, Deckard begins to struggle over the choices he makes, over the job he undertakes, over whether or not being a bounty hunter and offing androids is right. He has an affection for Rachel, who's an android. He distinguishes himself from the other bounty hunter, Phil Rash, who doesn't have a worry about murdering people. He doesn't really care, whereas Deckard has a moral struggle with this act. He ultimately takes care of the business he needs to take care of, and then in order to find himself again, find meaning, he takes his hover car out into the desert, and he momentarily, out in the Oregon desert, becomes Mercer. Or maybe he doesn't, but he thinks that he does. And he also out there finds a toad. Is the toad real or artificial? I won't spoil that for you. And it all makes sense, I think. Maybe. So, you'll read the book and find out. Now, if you're expecting Blade Runner exactly, you'll be disappointed. This is not the movie. There are aspects of the movie here, but this is more than the movie. It's actually, I thought, less noirish, but it does visit the existential themes of the film and magnifies quite a few of them. I think this is Dickian sci-fi philosophy at its best, and I give it 4.75 hits. Kurt, what did I miss? There's so much in this book.
Yeah, there is a ton in this relatively short book. There's a lot of different things going on, a lot of different themes, and the book has a lot to say. Let me start out by saying I'm not going to argue with your rating at all. I think, you know, for me, it's a 4.5 for this one. And it deserves all of that. I mean, this is a pretty important book of science fiction in the 20th century. And Dick is probably one of its most important writers. I think you are correct in saying that the film itself is a bit more noir than this book is. Part of that is just from the visualization that the films do. I mean, they make it darker, they make it bleaker. You know, you get some of those more noir concepts, but also these, at least for a first time reader, but someone who is very familiar with the films, this very unusual focus on the Mercerism elements, the cult like, the religious elements of this story. And, you know, that's a little bit unexpected. That doesn't really come through in the films, but I do think that the films are very true to the story of Decker and Rachel and the experience of being a bounty hunter. So for those reasons, you know, I really enjoy this work. I want to get, you know, a little deeper on some of these concepts. Overall, a very enjoyable read. It makes me want to check out a few more of Philip K. Dick's work because I feel like he's one of these authors that indirectly most of us are familiar with some element of his work, whether that's from a movie or a TV show or just the huge amount of people that he influenced as an author. We get a sense of him, but I've never really read much of him, and I consider myself at least at one time was a very big science fiction and fantasy fan.
I think that's a strange thing about Philip K. Dick is he is more well known than his work. People know him as a cultural icon because he sort of serves this function as a countercultural post-beatnik sci-fi legend in the same way that Che Guevara is known for the t-shirts and being this sort of vague revolutionary symbol, but people don't actually know anything about him other than very superficial shit. When people actually sit down and look at Philip K. Dick's work, it's fascinating that it actually holds up its end of the bargain. There's a lot of depth in his writing, and so many of his books got turned into films that so many people don't even recognize as being Dick's work. He's almost saturated what we know to be like sci-fi culture in the United States. He's a really fascinating specimen.
And, you know, going back to this particular book, is that the sheer volume of concepts in this book is kind of staggering, really. And when we were thinking about this, and we'd mentioned it last episode, but I hadn't really thought about it that much, you could have taken this book, and the film that we got was about the bounty hunting and about the androids, but you could have also taken this idea of mercerism, this post-World War III time frame where animals are disappearing, this sort of cult of the animal. You could also have made a film out of those concepts, and I think that could have worked as well. You know, kind of interesting to think you could take two very different films out of the same book, and there's probably many more angles to look at that I haven't mentioned. It strikes me the amount of really great content that is contained in these pages.
No, absolutely. And quite a few characters that are worth spending some time with.
There's a lot.
Yeah, there are. There are. And some are, you know, some I like better than others, and some are slightly more memorable. But we have Rick Deckard. He's our protagonist, bounty hunter, a.k.a. Blade Runner, which is not something that was ever referenced in this book. Blade Runner, the term, does not come from this. It actually comes from William S. Burroughs. He wrote a book called Blade Runner, a Movie, a long time ago, and that was one of the initial inspirations for the term Blade Runner. But that's a side note. Rick Deckard, he's our guy. Harrison Ford plays him in the film. We have Rachel Rosen, who was also in the film as Rachel somebody else, and her role is similar. And a couple other of the android roles are similar, but we have some other characters that are unique to this book. One of them in particular, I think, might be interesting to talk about. I'll see how you feel. J.R. Isidore, the chicken head.
Yes.
I thought he was an interesting character.
Yeah.
And then we have Phil Rash, the bounty hunter who works for the fake android-led police department. We have Rick Deckard's wife, Iran, who suffers from severe depression. And for me, sort of typify the 1950s era despair. Their whole domestic life was really fucking depressing with their status symbol animals, keeping up with the Joneses and her mood organ. The whole thing was a pretty rough subplot in this narrative. The other androids, Ray and Briss, and I want to call her Irmgard. Some of these characters we know a little bit more than others. And then there's Mercer, the leader of the religion Mercerism. There's other cops, too, that I just lost track of, but are there any characters that stand out to you that I named or maybe ones that I didn't?
Oh, boy. I think you've hit on all the major ones there. I mean, I think it's impossible not to put this in context of the film just because that's so ingrained in my head. But the relationships that are different within this book compared to the film, you're right, it's really bleak, it's really depressing, but the relationship between Rick and Iran or however you want to say that is really, that alone is worth some analysis just because it's so ugh.
yeah, real bummer.
Yeah, it's just a bad relationship, mental health issues. And how could you not, really? Because we're talking about a post-apocalyptic, essentially, world here. Most people, or many people who have the means, have gone off planet after this World War III experience. The world is radioactive. People aren't having children anymore. People have been mutated and affected by what's on Earth. I mean, it's a bleak landscape. And the idea that you would need mood enhancers and some little last grasp of nature to hold on to kind of makes sense. So that relationship is very interesting to me. And I think the other relationship you mentioned, Isidore, but his relationship with the other, the sort of last group of androids that exist, that is really interesting to me too, because that's not really a narrative that we get in the, especially the original Blade Runner. But I believe there's sort of a reference to it at the beginning of this latest Blade Runner, Blade Runner 2020, right?
2049, yeah.
Or 2040, yeah, 2049.
Starring Ryan Gosling. Yeah.
Came out in 2018 now. Either way, the newer Blade Runner, I think they allude to that group of androids somewhere in the, towards the beginning of the film. But the fact that these androids are essentially, I mean, in a lot of ways, they're just escaped slaves. And that issue, you know, is certainly a big one in there. There's so many, like, secondary characters that I don't really find all that interesting, but it's those two relationship groups that at least were compelling to me in the book.
I would agree. Isidore is a cool character. I wasn't sure about him at first, but I think Dick was very intentional in placing him as the sort of go-between between Deckard and the androids, because Isidore lives in this sort of liminal space, this middle ground. He's in a lot of ways been rejected by humans, despite being a human.
Yeah.
He's been abandoned. He's been left behind on Earth because he's not smart enough. He's been kept away from mercerism because he's not allowed access to something. He doesn't pass the test, so to speak.
Yeah, which is interesting.
Yeah, it is interesting. And I found that actually surprising. I'll be curious to see what you have to say.
Well, and what strikes me, and let's go back to this term that, you know, he's called a chicken head in the book, or at least that's the, what society labels these people, is that, you know, Isidore is not really described as, you know, whatever, quote unquote, simple in the book, but he really isn't. He's got some, like, nervous tics and, you know, maybe, I mean, and that could very well be a result of being labeled a chicken head. But the guy is not, you know, there's nothing like that crazy that's wrong with him. I mean, he's a pretty normal
he's
human being.
He's a functioning human being.
And in many ways, he's displaying, because of the way that he interacts and his with the androids and some of the other humans in the story, is, in fact, he shows at least a little more empathy than some of our supposed, you know, chosen humans do in the book.
I would agree with that. That's one of the key features of Isidore in this novel, was that,
yes,
if we raise the question of, and I have a question for you, who is the most human character in this novel? I would say that it might be Isidore. It might be one of the androids, but it certainly isn't Deckard. But then which definition of human am I using?
Yeah, well, you know, that's there again, that's the point of discussion I think Dick is bringing up. That's kind of the point of the novel. But yep. I think Isidore is the one that we would be most sympathetic to, but also the one that is perhaps supposed to be, I don't want to say a stand-in for us, but I think he's written in a way that the reader could certainly see themselves stuck in Isidore's position. I don't, you know, as far as what's human, I don't think it's Decker. I don't think it's Iron. It's certainly not Mercer or one of the androids, I don't think. So I think it has to be Isidore, unless you want to go with one of the secondary characters, perhaps the fake bounty hunter who's sort of duped by the androids. Like, he seemed fairly normal to me. But you certainly have to wonder, with all this mood alteration that is going on, like, what is normal anymore?
That's classic Philip K. Dick. I mean, this is a trippy book with a lot of themes that are ambiguous, and a lot of what is real, what is not. And he was a pretty smart guy, but he's also paranoid and a heavy drug user. So some of the philosophy can go the way of feeling cheapened by pharmaceuticals. But I think at its root, if we're going to pick a standout human in this book, it's going to be Isidore, serving as sort of the gateway of being empathetic and tolerant and considerate to androids, the bridge between him and the rest of the world. Decker being pretty much a killer for hire, and Isidore being the only human in this story we meet who is not a fucking cop, or is not, you know, severely depressed and married to a cop. So when we talk about the androids in this book, this is where it's dangerous to rewatch the films, because in the movies, the androids are much better developed as characters, particularly the character, like Rachel and Ray, some of the major androids in Blade Runner. do not have that kind of dominant role. The Ray in the novel is not played by Rutger Hauer, and he does not give some kind of fascinating performance with the dove in his hands. None of that happens. So I wouldn't say that any of these androids really stand out as being absolutely fascinatingly a draw for me, except perhaps I did find interest in the android, I forgot her name, who was the opera singer, who feels so human and behaves in such a human way, doesn't really seem to recognize her own position as we see it, or as humans see her, as the enemy, and calls the cops and tries to get out of her tight situation. What do you think about the androids in the book?
So you're basically saying that they're not as well described in the book?
They're not as well developed as in the movie. Like, I feel like they get offed relatively early. I feel like we don't have time to get to know that. They don't seem to have, nobody has a monologue.
Yeah. Yeah. The reason I ask is, you know, I purposely did not rewatch either film. And to me, they almost felt a little bit more described in the book. And that, and it, you know, well, maybe not more described, but a little bit more believable, or which in my mind leads to being more developed in some ways. And that, and that was because they weren't really superhuman-y.
Yes. I agree with that, that idea. Their lack of super strength in the book, the fact that they were weak and vulnerable humans, human-like people, operating in this world,
yeah,
trying to hide from the bad guy. Like, no, I'm sympathetic to them more so in the book, but I felt like none of them stood out in the way that a couple of them stand out in the movie.
That's sure. I'm comfortable with that. I mean, I guess the thing that strikes me is that, you know, in the films they feel very much like androids, and in the book I sympathize with them more, and they feel a little bit more human to me.
These are the least robotic androids, yes, you will ever meet. And I think that was yes, Dick's point.
And when he gets into all this, we don't need to get into this, but when he gets into all the model numbers and all this kind of stuff, like that's kind of like these Nexus 6 robots are supposed to be like the closest to humans. And that, I think, that makes sense in the way that he writes them in the book as well. So
before we move past characters, if we're getting to that point, I did want to quote one writer who was talking about or trying to describe Deckard.
Okay.
And this is a pretty harsh description, but I want to share it. This is written by Noah Berlatsky, and he writes, "A cop trying to earn enough cash to buy a robo-goat is a goofy, cute story hook, but it's also nightmarish. Deckard feels more compassion and empathy for his goat than he does for the virtually human androids he murders. Deckard feels like he isn't getting ahead in life, and like so many others, he turns his resentment into casual brutality at the expense of the marginalized."
Yes.
That's a very political statement, and it's very modern. Through one prism, this is totally accurate. But I do think that it undercuts Deckard a little. Deckard is trapped in a substrate that is outside of his control, and that he's a little more human and is seeking for mercerism or for transcendence or for something else than this quote gives him credit for.
Yeah, I'm going to call bullshit on that quote. The reason being is writer of that is not putting themselves in the context of the novel. Decker is existing in a society in which artificial life has been constructed and considered to be artificial life. There's obviously, and I think this is I think this is perhaps one of the reasons why we see this obsession with animals in the book, is that real biological life is disappearing on the planet. And he starts out the story with this robotic animal, and his whole desire is to have biologic life, right? So all of their thought process, their religion, everything is putting a value on biologic life because of the ramifications of this war that happened. So of course you're not going to, if somebody comes along and says, well, this is a robot, of course you're not going to value that as highly. Because it can talk to you doesn't necessarily give it value. I mean, my phone can talk to me. That doesn't mean my phone has more value than my cat. And it is an interesting conversation because it can go both ways. You can have the idea of when does AI gain sentience, and when does that then give it life or rights or what have you. And I mean, that's the whole, like, that's the whole premise of how many years of Star Trek The Next Generation and Data.
Oh, absolutely. I was going to say it's a question of Data.
And that's a thing, that's a discussion that science fiction is never going to answer, and humanity is going to take a long time to answer once we actually have to ask ourselves that question. But until we are forced for one reason or another, we're not going to have a definitive answer on that. I think we can provide an answer is that we're humans, we're animals, whether it's through a pet relationship or whatever, because we're animals, we have a connection to nature. We have a connection to biological life. We're always going to, we're pretty much, I think, always going to value biological life over artificial intelligence. Now, I'm not going to say that there aren't going to be individuals who believe otherwise, but I think as a society, that connection is much closer than some artificial intelligence. So to say that he's like, oh, he doesn't value the goat because it's a goat. He values it because it's a mammal in this case and a biological entity. He devalues the android because it's not a biological entity.
I think that's fair. And I think there's another way of looking at it, which the goat represents something that's being lost and it's looking back, and there's something nostalgic about looking back and holding on to the past. Whereas the android is the future. It's foreign. It's the other. It's the brave new world. And this world is already shit. And Deckard, if he's anything, he seems like a kind of guy who would be nostalgic for what's been lost. But it's more than just androids versus life. It's insiders and outsiders. This is a common thing that we deal with all the time in modern society. Who's in and who's out, and who gets to decide? And I mean, who gets to decide who gets Social Security benefits, who gets to have access to to healthcare? Who do we kick out of our country and for what reasons, and who do we allow to slip through the cracks to serve whatever function they serve? We're making these decisions all the time, and it's a very animal thing. Territory, who's part of the family, who gets thrust outside and becomes the enemy. If we're going to continue to be humans, we're going to probably always have these types of struggles within us. Maybe eventually we'll become transhumans and cyborg entities, and we will no longer have this question. But then the question will be, are we human anymore? So, but that's for another. Yeah. We don't have to worry about that yet.
Let's not get into that. But I guess if we're going to judge Decker or this society's actions, let's judge them on how they're handling this, and probably poorly in this situation. Issue from the name we know it's poor, the chicken heads in like Isidore, rather than the artificial intelligence. So if we're going to critique them, I think that's a fairer critique, but I get your argument there. I think for me, what this story says is something a little bit more base, than that, it's a disconnection of people and nature.
I would agree with that more than the argument that I made, which was someone else's. But there are other things going on in this book that I think we should be spending some time focusing on. I was surprised to find out that Isidore and other chicken heads do not have access to mercenaries. I was like, huh, that's weird.
I would agree with you that seems sort of odd that they wouldn't have access, because in fact you'd think that would be, they'd almost have more access.
Yeah, like it's a distraction and serves the marginalized peoples of the world, gives them something to yearn for or believe in. If mercerism or any religion for that matter is a grand distraction and a source point of meaning, whether it's fiction or reality, isn't the function to provide that space for people who don't have anything? Yeah. And I thought that would pass the time, at least for the chicken heads on Earth, to have something to yearn for in light of the apocalypse. There's no future for Earth. Earth's not going to get better.
Yeah, and I think you're making a good point. And I mean, just to remind listeners here that this mercerism is ingrained with this. You get this mood organ thing, and you can see visions of Mercer while you're having your mind altered. And, there's elements of this cult of obsession around animals is linked to this as well. And I was a little unclear about exactly what Mercer was supposed to have done earlier on, but it had something to do with like bringing life back from the dead, or you know, something very biblical sounding. Although
like the mutants in some of the Marvel stories, he was some kind of superhuman anomaly who had the special powers. So the authorities didn't want people to know about his special power. He brought an animal back to life. So they were like relegated him to a hole or something. And he spent his whole life climbing up on bones of dead things, trying to get to the top of this pit that he was stuck in. And his whole life is trying to get out of this pit. And he just does that. And when you enter the Mercer box, the empathy box, you join him in a sense, trying to get out of this pit, climbing the hill like Sisyphus, trying to get out. But it would be lonely if it was just you alone, but you're with everybody else. You all get in there and climb the pit together and feel part of something. So there you go, I guess.
Yeah.
But the question is it just another fiction in a fiction? Toward the end of the novel, it's made fairly clear that the accusations made on national television by Buster Friendly that Mercer is a total fraud. It's just a sham religion made to distract people. But then after that, we have, what's his name, Deckard going out to the Oregon desert and bonding with Mercer and feeling as if not only is he with Mercer, but he is alone and is Mercer. And he comes back and somebody says, Mercer is a sham. And he says, no, he's not. No easy answers from Philip K. Dick.
No, certainly not. What I wanted to do there was sort of compare what you were saying about the Mercerism and exclusion to this idea of Buster Friendly. And as you pointed out, Buster Friendly, and first of all, if you haven't read it yet, but Buster Friendly is sort of like a 24-hour gossip channel. It's like,
oh my God,
it's kind of like
the worst.
It sort of sounds like if Good Morning America was run by like some sort of hyperactive, super goofy host 24 hours a day.
Yeah, like Steve Allen or one of those old comedy guys, but like on pep pills.
It
feels like real high energy and always new guests, but the same guests keep returning and there's never a break. Guests will be on there for hours and hours.
Which is accessible to anyone, including the chicken heads. And,
like a religion.
Yes, and exactly. So in a way here, we have also a tale of two competing religions going at it. And it's interesting to me that, well, we find out that Buster Friendly is actually an android, but we also, Aaron Deckard, she watches when she's not on her mood box, she's pretty much watching Buster Friendly as well. So here's this android essentially attempt to kind of replace the religion on the world with Buster Friendly. And I did think it was interesting that, you know, we can talk about how ridiculous this hyperactive 24-hour entertainment guy is, but man, this really, you know, this is written pre 24-hour news networks, pre Instagram, pre Facebook, all of these things, and it's really not that different.
No, I mean, yes, this is 1968. This precedes so much of our modern existence, and he's really on point with the perpetual distraction box that is in our pocket. On our laptop, on the TV, on the radio, it doesn't end. You can always be distracted. And at what point does that serve as our distraction from the world and our salvation even from the world, our point of connection, our place where we get empathy? I look at dying koalas on the television, on my computer from the Australian fire crisis, and I have empathy, but then I go to work and I'm all bitter and cynical. Where am I getting my humanity from? There could be a fairly solid case that this functioning is almost religious or community oriented, and that Dick was pretty prescient in that regard.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think we've touched enough on this angle of religion, unless there's something else that you wanted to go to.
No, I'm good.
Let's move into one element of craft then. And I think since we talked about it in the previous episode, I'd like to mention a couple of things about world building here. And that is, you know, obviously this is Earth, but it's a different Earth. Let's call it an alternative history Earth, because this stuff, at least in the book, has essentially passed us by.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, some of these interesting elements that he did in his world building for this book is, and we've talked about this extensively, but the religious elements, but throwing these little things in there, like Decker carrying around this catalog, this worn catalog in his pocket of Sydney's animal and fowl catalog.
Yes.
Which he can, you know, we can look through and see like What's the going rate for a goat? What's the going rate for a dog? What's, you know, and these prices change monthly, and everybody, it seems like the economy almost shifts around, or at least to Decker's economy does, this animal catalog. So I thought that was like a nice touch of like adding a sense of realism to the world. There's a mention, I mean, because we've talked again about the radioactivity, but there's talk of these lead cod pieces that men who have not been affected by the radiation yet have to wear. I mean, most of it focuses around this mercerism and that. But I mean, I think he does a good job of taking the world that we're in, twisting it a little bit, and then making that twist seem very believable. And so I think that's a good thing with world building. Just change enough. Just change a little bit.
I would agree. He doesn't change too much. Had I not watched the films, would I know that Deckard's car is a hover car? I know he parks on the roof. I know he comes down from the roof. But it isn't like Dick spends two pages describing the cars and the traffic flying over the city in the way that we get the bird's eye view in the movies. None of that is described. It's just almost implied through him parking on the roof. Those types of things are like the little details he adds, and we have to fill in the blanks. Sometimes I want a little bit more, whereas Titan Shade, for example, was very well crafted with world building. It didn't overdo it for me. It's also a longer book. I sometimes felt that I could have done with, if he added five more pages to this book, I would have wanted them to be descriptive pages where we would get little snippets of more detail of what the city looked like in the wake of nuclear disaster and overpopulation and all those things. That being said, I'd rather have him undersell it than overdo it and turn it into an epic fantasy where you describe a sword for eight pages. So you know, which flip a coin, which one do you prefer? So that's one aspect of craft. I thought the writing just was clear and effortless.
Yes.
I wouldn't call Dick a poet. He just writes really well. It's just consistent and it's not over detailed. Just good writing. It's neutral. And if somebody says your writing is neutral, I don't even see it, I'm too enraptured by the story, then I'd call that a success.
Yeah. And I think one thing we could say is some science fiction and fantasy writers could go back to this earlier material and take some notes on how you can still tell this immersive science fiction tale and not get too verbose in what you're doing.
Yeah, without purple prosing it or turning it into what essentially reads as a technical manual.
Yeah, that's another problem.
In terms of historical context, I mean, this book is in sci-fi, in noir, in Hollywood, in culture, in predicting. There's a lot of, this is a bedrock important piece of writing that came out in an important moment in U.S. and global history, 1968. This is the year that social revolutions were on the precipice of happening and change was afoot. A lot of stuff was happening. Then this book came out and has been very prescient in predicting and anticipating and fearing things that have come to pass.
You can't overstate the importance of Philip K. Dick in this genre. And I, you know, you could spend an entire podcast series just talking about that, to be honest. It is highly influential. And you're right. This is the type of work that, as you said, anticipates an entirely new genre of fiction. That's a big deal. That there's so many elements of this work and his other work that, you know, has really propelled how people think about the genre for since it's been written. What is this, 50 years, something like that?
Yeah. Philip K. Dick, he's been long gone, but his books, his films live on. This novel is legend more for what it propagated than for itself. But I would say ultimately that this is a book worth reading, even if you are listening to us because you like hard-boiled mystery and noir fiction and aren't into sci-fi. I still think this serves as an interesting crossover read because of the questions it raises. And one thing we didn't talk about earlier is what other elements do sci-fi bring to noir to enhance it, or what do they have in common? And one thing is the themes about society and asking the big questions. And some punch-em-up hard-boiled noir books don't really do that. It's not really the point. There's an underdog and there's bad guys and there's corruption and some shit goes down. But some of the better works, some of the best works of both genres are asking big questions, not answering them, but raising them and letting characters play out their lives in the context of these bigger themes. Because these are the kind of books that end up becoming universal, they end up becoming rereadable, and they end up becoming books that are read from generation to generation because they're saying something about the human experience. And while this might not have as much rain-soaked San Francisco nights and gumshoe detectives getting in fistfights and alleyways as I would like as a noir and hardboiled fan, it does have enough of those elements in combination with these larger heavy-duty themes that make me feel like I'm chewing something good. I'm eating a real good burger or omelet and not eating a grilled cheese with American cheese and white bread. This is a real meaty story, and it raises questions we are still asking.
Yeah, for sure. This is a classic for a good reason. All right, speaking of classics, next up we have Forgotten Classics.
Forgotten Classics.
Indeed. Is it a forgotten classic is the question for today. And the book that we have is Home is the Sailor by Day Keene. So this originally came out in 1952. It was a gold medal. I read the hard case crime version. And let's start out with Day Keene. First of all, this is a pen name based on his mother's maiden name. He was born Gunnard Hurtstead. Or Heardstead.
That rolls off the tongue.
You can see why that might be changed, because through his life, he was he started out as an actor, actually, and then he became a writer and a producer, writer for radio and television scripts. So that was his main job, radio and television writing. He was born in 1904 in Chicago. He would die in 1969 in Los Angeles. He was known as an excellent plotter and did believable but interesting twists in his fiction. He wrote 50 novels, and as I said, he was a head writer for radio soap operas. He would be published his short stories in Black Mask, Dime Detective, and Detective Tales. He would publish books under the labels of Gold Medal, Graphic, and Ace. Most of his novels came out in the 1950s. Readers of other works in this period will recognize his work to be similar to that of Gil Brewer or Harry Whittington. Some of his most notable books are Framed in Guilt. That's his first novel in 1949. The Big Kiss Off, 1954. Home is the Sailor in 1952. And to connect this to our last forgotten classic, he even had a couple of carnival-themed books, including Carnival of Death in 1965.
I was just about to make a joke about a book being called Carnival of Death, and then I remembered and you declared that it actually is one.
There you go. Joy House was made into a film in 1964, and he sort of stops writing crime fiction in the 60s. He starts getting into more literary fiction. One of his novels, which is, I want to pronounce it Schwamagon, but I don't think that's quite right. But it was made into the Elvis film, The Trouble with Girls, in 1969. So that's, you know, with Elvis starring, that's a pretty big deal.
Mm-hmm.
So let's look at this book, Home is the Sailor. Basically, and you're going to feel like we're in a Charles Williams novel here. Our main character, his name is Swede Nelson. Well, Swede Nelson, he's a sailor. He's been out for years. He's been working as a mate, a chief mate. He's been making his money and saving it up, and he's come back to shore because he wants to go home to Minnesota and buy himself a farm. Makes sense for a guy named Swede Nelson, right?
Pretty much.
Pretty much right away, he, as sailors might do after being gone for years, he gets drunk in a bar in California. He gets into an altercation, which leads him to be in a hotel owned by Carice Mason. Well, through a brief romance, the two of them end up getting married. All of a sudden, instead of having his farm in Minnesota, Swede Nelson is the proprietor or co-proprietor of a hotel. What could go wrong?
Murder.
Well, murder, indeed. Murder happens. Carice Mason, basically, and this, I think you find this out pretty quickly, but she cons Swede Nelson here into covering up a murder that she committed. Who is she? Is she actually Chris Mason? Is this actually her hotel? What is going on here? And, well, what we end up having is Swede gets himself into further and further trouble in embracing the truest elements of noir fiction as things spiral out of control. And how is this all going to resolve itself? Ultimately, we're asking the question, is this a forgotten classic? I'm going to be a little more generous here, and I'm going to say yes. I think this is a forgotten classic.
If I had a bell, I'd ding it.
Yes. Yes. Now, there are elements of this book I didn't necessarily like, but I think that Keene does handle this spiral of the situation getting worse and worse for Swede Nelson as the situation gets murkier and murkier. I think rather than a novel, this would make a pretty excellent film noir. And I think that maybe his chops as a television and radio scriptwriter is what's coming through. But overall, I did enjoy this novel. I think that you could check out Keene's work, and probably, you know, there are some things that have been reprinted in addition to this tale. I think you're going to see some good noir work here. I think you're going to see some good fiction. This is the only one I've read of his, but I would give it a tentative recommend. But I think if you look over some of the sillier elements, he sort of magnifies this Swede Nelson drunken sailor element a bit much. I think that's what threw me off. But if you look at this core idea of man ends up in quick marriage with perhaps shady woman, what could go wrong? Then I think it's a good story.
That one makes me want to revisit Charles Williams again. I haven't read one since our fourth episode way back when.
I will always enjoy a Charles Williams book. If you don't like the nautical stuff, his shore-based stuff is good as well. Home is the Sailor. All right, so today's challenge is to do five round burst in actually 5 minutes. And to do that today, Justin, what I'd like you to do is, do you have a timepiece available?
Let me pull up a stopwatch. I do have one.
And if you could give me each minute as it happens, then I can try to do this five round burst in actually 5 minutes. How about that?
I will do that.
All right, here we go. In 3, 2, 1, five round burst. First up, The Automatic Detective. This came out in 2008 from Tor Books by A. Lee Martinez. Now, Martinez is best described as sort of a fantasy sci-fi, like humorist sort of guy. And that comes through in this book, The Automatic Detective, where you basically have a robot who's gained sentience in the Empire City. And he has to fully gain his citizenship, he has to be like psychologically evaluated and all of these sorts of things. Well, he starts out the book as a cab driver. His neighbors get kidnapped, and he compels himself to search for his neighbors. And in the course of that, he basically becomes a robot detective. Now, this is fun. It is a little funny. It has super science and stuff like that. And it definitely nods an homage to the classics of detective fiction. But overall, The Automatic Detective is a classic of this genre. And I think it's a hit and a great example of the crossover sci-fi and noir genre.
1 minute. Perfect.
Next up, Low Town by Daniel Polansky. This came out in 2010. It's from First Archer Books. And I read this one quite a while ago, so I'm having a little bit of trouble remembering it. But this is truly actually a fantasy noir, and that is pretty rare. So that's why I came back to this one. We have a murdered child. We're on the mean streets, or the poor section of a fantasy town called Rigas. And the local drug dealer is sort of a fallen member of the secret police. He used to be a war hero, those sorts of things. He's nicknamed is the Warden. Well, for one reason or another, this child's death propels the Warden, I think it reminds him of himself as a child, to investigate the murder, which it brings him in touch, as you might expect, with his old life as a member of this black house, the secret police, and of his connections to the military. And of course, there's a wizard involved. Now, I remember. Yeah. So
2 minutes has passed.
All right. So comparing this to other fantasy, I think this is a very good noir example, and I will give it a hit. Next up is City and the City by Chana Mayville, which I mentioned before. This came out, which is amazing to me, in 2009. It's 10, 11 years old, from Macmillan. Now, this is a Hugo Award. There's a lot of stuff about this. I'll keep this fairly simple. What this is a sort of modern fantasy novel of two parallel cities, Bezel and Ulkumoma. Well, these two cities essentially exist in the exact same place in almost parallel dimensions. People can see from outside the city. You can see both cities at the same time, but you're not allowed to acknowledge one city or the other. You only gain entrance to one city. So both cities have their own airport, their own police, blah, blah, blah. If you're actually a member, a citizen of this town, it's actually a violation of, or known as the breach, to notice a citizen or buildings or crime or anything from the other city. Now, as you might imagine, this draws a lot of parallels of like Eastern Europe, post-Soviet or Soviet countries, what can be seen, what's legal, what's not. Mayville is a challenging writer. He will make you think this isn't going to be for everybody, but for me, this was a hit, a very enjoyable read, City in the City. There's also a BBC version if you would prefer to watch it. I don't know if that's any good.
3 minutes and 40 seconds. I forgot to say the last one.
Oh, man. Okay. All right. Well, I'm not going to make it in 5 minutes, but The Plotters is next. This came out in 2019, at least in translation. It was originally written in 2010, came out from Anchor Books. This is by Eun Soo Kim. This is a South Korean book translated by Sora Kim Russell. Here we follow an assassin, Ren Sang, who works for the, quote, library, home of an old assassination plotter, the Old Raccoon. He's been ahead of the world of assassination in Korea for decades, and now there's a power struggle. This power struggle emerges once Ren Sang has an assassination that doesn't go quite right. Power dynamics shift. It's violent. It's political. It's a thriller with a noir angle. I would strongly recommend The Plotters. It was a very good book. Last up,
4:45,
and I'm not going to do it in 15 seconds. But last up is actually a cozy mystery, which was crazy for me to read. And this is The Zigzag Girl by Ellie Griffiths. This came out in 2014. It's from Mariner Books. And the reason I read this is because the premise is these former members of a World War II special operations group, the Magic Men, reassemble in 1950s Brighton to solve a murder which is based on a magic trick. So we have a detective inspector, Edgar Stevens, and the magician, Max Mephisto, come together to solve these murders. It brings back in their former colleagues from World War II. I'll keep this brief because I was drawn in by this magic World War II angle. I thought the author kind of dropped the ball on the potential there. And while I kind of enjoyed the book overall, I think it's a miss for me. That's 5-round burst. What did I do that in? 6.5 minutes, Justin?
6 minutes.
Okay. Well,
hey, the last episode, it took 22 minutes for us to do it. So that's a slight improvement.
Yes. So that's 5-round burst. And I believe with that, we're going to be wrapping up this episode. Justin, what do we have to look forward to here in the future?
Well, we're going to get back to modern times and get back to some old hard-boiled classic noir fiction. We're going to visit Richard Stark's The Hunter. This has been a book that some people have asked us to do, and finally we're going to deliver. Richard Stark is a pseudonym for Donald E. Westlake, and The Hunter is a classic anti-hero hard-boiled piece of writing that was the inspiration for two different films called Point Blank. That's the book that we're going to read for episode 44 and 45. In episode 46 and 47, we're going to go out to Hawaii, take a little vacation, and investigate Hawaiian noir. We'll let you know about the books we decide to read for that, but it might be more than one book that we feature. So, how do they contact us, Captain Kurt?
Well, you can always find us on Facebook, Point Blank, Hardboiled Noir, and Detective Fiction. You can send us an email at pointblanknoir@gmail.com or find us on Twitter at pointblanknoir. You can also review the show. That helps. Do that on iTunes or whichever player you prefer to use. In the meantime, I guess, watch out for androids.
Beware.
Thanks for listening.
Bye.
Blank is under a Creative Commons license. Music is by Justin. Copywritten works are property of their respective holders.